Yeah, we're in the midst of a series called Set Free, and it's been really fun. I think Romans is the best book in the Bible. I think chapter 8 of Romans is the best chapter of the Bible. I'm not going to say what we're about to preach is the best paragraph in the best chapter in the best book of the Bible, but it's close. And it's about suffering, which is really strange. When we decided to embrace and kind of unpack Romans 8, I dreaded and I was anxious and I was excited about this sermon. Because a lot of us, and some very recently, as of yesterday, understand what suffering is. We get it. It's unavoidable in our lives. And I'm going to just beseech God and pray for us one more time before we actually get into this, because I just believe I just need him right now. I just need his spirit right now, because this is, I need you to walk away from this sermon understanding the passage, okay? Because if we don't have a good theological heart position, if we don't have a good heart position towards God, when suffering comes, you're gonna bail on God. Like you will bail on God. You've met those people, maybe you've been that person. When the hard times come, you bail on God, because we have a poor theology of what suffering is. We have a poor understanding of why suffering happens. And so we, in the next few minutes, are gonna take on a very massive subject and try to figure out why they're suffering. I had a student, I taught political science for many years in college, and I had a student, she went to a church that wasn't really the kind of theology that I embrace, but I'm glad she was in church. And she would walk into my class and she would say all the time, she's like about to take a test, and she was like, in Jesus' name, you're gonna give me an A. And I was like, girl, Jesus in studying is gonna help you right now. But she had the mindset that if she just called upon the name of Jesus, she would get anything she wanted because she was a Christian. Nothing ever bad was ever gonna happen to her. She was gonna have health, she was gonna have wisdom, she was gonna have wealth, all those things, all those prosperity things that we see attached to the gospel so wrongly at all the times. And so at the end of the semester, we found out through some other students and faculty that Lauren, the girl's name, the student, her dad passed away in a car accident. Horrific event, right? And she came into the room, and she were about to take final exams, and she actually showed up for final exams. I begged her not to come, said, look, we get it. You know, you can, you don't have to be here. And she came in, and she just started weeping. So I took her outside, and me and this other professor were sitting there, and we're just praying over her and trying to care for her. It was at Dallas Baptist University, and so we're just trying to care for her well. And she looked at me, and she goes, Mr. Rainey, why would God do this? My dad was a faithful Christian, a deacon in our church. I've loved God. What did I do? She kept saying, what did I do for God to allow my father to die? Now, that wasn't the time for me to step in and give her a lesson on suffering or theology. She just needed to be loved. But that's the danger. And then in the end of that conversation, she's like, I think I'm just done with this whole thing. You know. Now, thankfully, Lauren has come back around. I've kept in touch with her Facebook friends, and everything's good. Like, she's good. She's dealt with that. She's loved well, she's about to get married. I mean, all these exciting things are happening, but if we're not careful, when we have that tragedy in our life, we don't have a good understanding of suffering and the hope that comes in suffering and the hope to come when suffering is over with, when Jesus returns and every tear is gone, all sickness is put done away, and he comes and reclaims his kingdom. If we don't have that perspective, we will bail on God when suffering comes. So if you're okay with this, I'm gonna just pray real quick for us this morning so that we can get a great understanding of what this is, because it's very important that we do. Father God, creator of everything, we humbly come before you and ask that you will reveal your spirit, reveal your wisdom, reveal what you want for us to be revealed to in this passage that you have put in the lips of Paul and written for our benefit. God, may we see this as a tool to help us understand and fall more in love with you, and not a way to justify, not a way to figure out, not even a way to maybe even explain, but just to understand your nature and your purposes and why things happen they do. Though we're not going to have all the answers and may never have all the answers, Father, let us come away with this trusting you more, that you are in control, that you are sovereign. As the psalm says, you are on your throne, and you do as you please, and what you please is always good for us. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Last week we talked about, a couple weeks ago, we talked about being children of God and that we're adopted, and we've been harping on Romans 8:1, and I'm sure all of you can probably not quote it by memory, but I'll go ahead and say it again. In Romans chapter 8, verse 1, the very first verse that we tackled in this series, it says, "Therefore, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." That is our victory song. That is our hope. That is where we rely on. That's where we run to in the best of times. That's where the verse we run to in the worst of times, because that tells us no matter what we have done, no matter where we have gone, no matter sins that we have offended God with, that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. That is our banner. And then lastly, we talk about who you are and whose you are. And I really just thought that was a fun time to understand that you are a child of God. If you know and love and have met Jesus, you are a daughter, you are a son of the King Most High. And you are an inheritor of all his inheritance. And that does not mean, though, that there will be not any suffering. Because we look at Romans 8:1 and we go, okay, Pastor, I don't understand that, because if there's no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus, why is there suffering? Well, look in Romans chapter 8, verse 16, real quick with me. This isn't part of the passage we're looking at. We talked about this last week, but look what Paul says there. He says, "The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer, okay, with him in order that we may also be glorified with him." In glorification, really what glorification really means is there will be a day where we will be resurrected with Christ. We have new creation bodies. There'll be a new kingdom, a new heaven, a new earth for those who love Jesus, right? We will be glorified with Jesus as he is glorified and comes to reign forever. In that day, until that time, that's happened, but the yet and not to come, when we are waiting along that day, there will be suffering. And Paul just says, on the road to glorification, there's suffering. And if you've been alive for more than 5 minutes, you understand suffering. I mean, at any time, there is a moment, and unfortunately it comes to some of us way too young to understand what suffering is, but there's a moment where it clicks, either we're a child or we're a young adult, and we go, we understand what suffering is. Because we have felt it, we have lost someone, we are battling some kind of health disease, we lose our job. We never know when it's gonna come, but we know and for sure that it's gonna come. And that's why if you ever hear somebody say, just trust Jesus and everything's gonna work out, look at his disciples. Look at the 12 disciples that followed Jesus and gave up their entire life, right? All of them but one, okay, one betrayed him, and then all of them but one died a martyr. Terrible retirement plan to follow Jesus, okay? There's a time when Jesus is talking to Peter and he goes, hey, look, when you get older, they're gonna take your hand to places you don't wanna go. And he was foretelling his death. Like he was like, you're gonna come follow me, you're gonna go build my church, you're gonna be my rock, Peter, and you're gonna die for me. Let's go. But that's the reality of it. But with Jesus, the sting of death is taken away. With Christ, the sting from death. And though we will all die, and we will all leave this earth, we all are just mortal, finite creatures, the sting of that death through Jesus is taken away. Because why? There's no condemnation in Christ. Okay, so as we look and understand this, there's a couple of things we need to unpack. But before I do that, I'm just going to read the entire passage that we're going to try to go through today. And you can just read along with me starting in verse 18. I typically don't do this, but we're going to go back to the front and then break it down, because I need you to hear what Paul is saying here. It says, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing," there's that word glory again, "with the glory that is to be revealed to us," a future glory that is to be revealed to us. "For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willing, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Not that hope that is seen is in not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what he does not see, we wait for it with patience." We may get farther than that, we may not, I'm not sure. I kind of left this when I sent my slides to everybody. I was like, it's gonna be kind of open-ended. We'll see where the Spirit takes us. So a few things. No, I don't have a speech problem or anything like that. I've emphasized the word creation because it's really important that you see that Paul is talking about the creation. He's talking about the global suffering that happens, okay? I read, and I don't even know if this is true because this is just really poor research on my part. I read somewhere that in the United States, there's gonna be close to, you know, 100,000 deaths today And I'm sure there may be, that probably is an inflated or deflated number. I'm not sure. But that's just staggering to think about. Right now, there is going to be, I think I read somewhere where there's going to be like almost 300,000 people are going to die of starvation today. I mean, this world is broken. I mean, it's just it's a carousel of death, is it not? I mean, we look on the news this last week and we see the bombing that happened in Africa and people losing their lives. We've got to rejoice because of this broken world where Pastor Saeed is now freed after 3 years of being enslaved and for his faith in the Middle East. But there are victories, there are defeats, but there is suffering all the less. And we know it, we see it, we feel it, we understand it. And so we are going to try to figure out why that is and where does the hope that we find in verse 17 when Paul talks about that this is not really worth what's to come. But let's skip that and go to verse 18 real quick. Here we go. Excuse me, 19. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willing, but because of him who subjected it in hope. So a few things we need to talk about. Verse 20, for him who subjected it into futility. Paul's talking about Adam and Eve, right? The fall. For those who maybe don't have a church background, creation of the world was good for a whole 5 minutes, okay? Genesis 1, creation, awesome, everything's great. Genesis 2, lovely, worshiping God. Genesis chapter 3, everything goes south, real quick. And Adam and Eve chooses to disobey God. It's the serpent, Satan, was there to persuade them and to lure them away from God and his presence and his worship. And they said, we need something more than that. And they disobeyed God, ate of the fruit, and sin came into the world. Now, the result of that, and you gotta hear this, was verse 20. Then him, God, set into the earth futility. He made the earth futile. He made the earth like it is today. And you can step back and go, if you don't have a understanding of God's holiness and God's righteousness, you may think that's just a real big overreaction from God, isn't it not? I mean, come on. God, seriously, it was a fruit. One rule broken, right? I mean, so if we're not careful, we'll see this is an overreaction to God, from God. He just, well, that was kind of blowing your top a little bit, don't you think, Lord? Now the whole earth is broken. Now they have to leave Eden. Now the garden is no more. And I mean, that's kind of an overreaction, don't you think, Lord? The reality is that when God is the centerpiece of all of our hope, if he is complete, there is no evil within God. He never has a fleeting moment, a weak moment or thought that is not pure righteousness and holiness. God doesn't take an off day from holiness. Do you understand? God doesn't sit here and go, well, I'm just too tired to do what I'm supposed to do, all right? There's never a thought in his mind that is not pure, perfect, and righteous. Because of that, because of what he's given to us through Jesus, because of everything who God is and continues to show us to be from the beginning of time to will be till the end of time, we understand that it's not an overreaction, but it's exactly the reaction that had to happen because of the sin that was offensive that God can't be around. God cannot be around sin. His righteousness cannot be reigned over sin, okay? So it wasn't an overreaction. It was the appropriate response when people who have everything in their midst, everything they've ever wanted, there in worship, in sync with God, sin, the response is to set the worth into futility. But not just in futility, but what? Keep reading the verse. It says, in hope. In hope. Because in the curse, Genesis chapter 3, right? God's like, he's upset, he's mad, right? Or whatever, and he's talking to everybody that's involved, all the characters. So here's the scene, right? You have the serpent right here, okay? This Satan, you have Adam and Eve, his first human creation, and you have all creation, Eden, everything's perfect, right? They disobey God, sin enters into the world, and then he has to curse. He's giving out curses, and he gives out curses, and all this stuff. And then he starts talking to the serpent, and he goes, look, there's gonna be strife, or there's gonna be conflict between you and the woman, the seed of the woman. The seed of Eve is who? You, me, everybody in this room, and particularly Jesus. And there's gonna be conflict between your seed and her seed, and he will come and crush your head, though you will bite his heel. And I'm paraphrasing there, but what he's pretty much saying is, there will come a day in hope that Jesus is gonna come and make all this right again. There's gonna come a day where the sins of this world that everyone now has inherited because of what happened this day will be made right. and will be restored. All creation will be restored because of my son Jesus. Though he will have to die, that's the bruising of the heel or the biting of the heel, he will crush sin and death forever. And on the third day after Christ's death, when he was not in that tomb, when they rolled away the boulder and saw there was nothing there, all the promises of God came true, and he was alive and well and showed himself amongst his followers, that prophecy reigned in. And death's sting was defeated forever. Now we are in the present of God's reign, and we are waiting for Jesus to come and reclaim, all right? We're waiting for the second coming, because even though when we know Jesus, we still feel the residual effects of sin. We still see the futility of the earth all the time and suffering. I mean, there's typhoons, there's going to be tsunamis, there's going to be hurricanes, there's going to be all these natural disasters. And look, this isn't a political statement. All right, hear this. I'm not trying to get political with you, but the reason why God cares about creation, why I think we should steward creation, is because it's groaning in futility, waiting for God to return. And so he gives us a mandate. He says, you need to go cultivate the earth. You need to be stewards of culture. You need to be the people that I've asked you to be and steward what I've given you. Now, I'm not trying to get political. It's just biblical. Okay? That doesn't mean you got to run and believe this about whatever global, whatever. You don't have to run and believe about environmentalists, this. I don't care what you believe in that. Just understand God's giving this creation that is broken to us to steward because it longs and awaits for Jesus' return so it can be restored. So God was not an overreaction when he set the earth into futility. It was a perfect reaction to sin. Exodus chapter 15, verse 11. Just listen. It says this. Who is like you, O God? Who is like you, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like you, majestic in holiness, awesome in glorious deeds, doing wonders? If you have met Jesus, you have felt that. Who is like you, O God? I'm going to tell you right now, my affections do not always portray and abide in God. Not all the time. I am broken. I am a sinner just like you. I know all of us in here this morning before we even got here probably had that problem. If you have children, you have that problem. I'm going to invent something that's not media that keeps kids quiet on Sunday mornings on the way to church. I have every great intention to pray on my way to church. And ever since my beautiful daughters have decided they want to come early with dad, prayer has turned into, please stop, don't tattle, don't do this, don't do that. This is just a side note. I'm working on it, parents. I'm praying for God to reveal it to me, and we're going to make millions. Okay. So the reality is, we are broken people. We are sinners. And God's wrath we deserve. And the creation we see around us that is broken, ourselves that we see as broken, is because of sin. Now don't hear me say this. I'm not saying bad things happen to you individually, cancer, losing job, whatever the case may be, because of your sin. Personally, God's not looking at you going, you should do better, cancer. Because if that was God, then what would we do? We'd try to do good all the time in order to please him and get good blessings from him. And then God doesn't become God of the world. It becomes karma. You know what karma is? If I do good, then good will be done to me. If I do things great, things will be done to me. If I'm really, really great and really, really awesome and help every little lady across the street, if I go and volunteer to all these things, if I give of my time and my resources, then God will truly love me. And then good things will happen to me. You are impossible. It is an impossible task to get God's approval. That's why you need Jesus. Because he has already been approved as the unblemished lamb, as a sacrifice for our sins. And we have faith in Jesus. That becomes our representation to God that we are children. And that's the good we deserve. That's wrapped up in the person of Jesus Christ. Let's keep reading. Verse 20. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope. In hope. God didn't respond to sin and go, well, that's it. It's good for 5 minutes and all creation, it's just a dumpster fire. From the very beginning, God knew. Because Jesus was there. I love it. If you go to chapter 1 in Genesis 1, it says that, and God went down and made us in his image, okay? Or made man in his image. And he said, he's talking to the Trinity. He goes, let us go down, right? Let us go down and make man in our image. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Jesus was there at the beginning. He was always plan A. He was never plan B. He was always there at the beginning. And what an amazing God to set into place when the first sin happened, that he pushed play on the redemptive process that he was going to play out many years later. He thought of you, he thought of me, and he gave the most precious gift in hope that the futility of the world would not last forever, that the futility of creation would not linger. Verse 21, the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain freedom of the glory of the children of God, for we know that the creation has been groaning together in pains of childbirth until now. So a few things that we need to talk about. Because of the time before creation was broken, you know, when Adam and Eve was run with God, before sin had come into the world, there's a time coming where that second Eden is coming. When Jesus returns and all glory will be rained down upon this earth and there will be no more cancer, there'll be no more war, there'll be no more deaths, there'll be no more funerals. There will be no more orphans. No one will go hungry again. No more natural disasters. Where we cry to God and say, why? Help. It'll all be made right. And that is the hope that we long for and that those who know Jesus will see. Why use in this passage a woman in labor and equal that to creation? There's two times of pain, right? Ladies who've had babies, you understand this passage more than any of us guys could ever understand, right? Amen? And the lady said, amen, all right. Paul uses childbirth. He could have used any analogy there, right? He could use pain as in pain of crucifixion, which he knows very much about. He could use pain of stoning, which he'd been almost stoned and killed several times. Pain and suffering of being in prison. He could have used any analogy that he could, but he uses this one because every woman knows the pain in childbirth is the price we pay for the glorious child we get to receive after the fact. And that is what the creation is doing. It's in childbirth, laboring pains, waiting for the new day to come. For the new earth to come. That's what this passage is saying. That's why it's using that analogy. Out of all the analogies you could use, they use that one because there'll be a day where new life comes, where we will finally get to experience in our glorified bodies, in our resurrected bodies, where there's no more brokenness, no more cancer, no more death, no more war, no more anything, and we get to worship Jesus for the rest of our days. We get to be in the throne room of God for the rest of our days, and the kingdom will have come, and we don't have to sing about, oh Lord, let your kingdom come, because it will be here, because the new birth will happen. And we will praise God because we are the ones that he decided before the beginning of the earth, I'm gonna set into place my redemption plan through Jesus. He didn't leave us to the futility, but set the earth in futility, why? In hope. Go back to verse 18. All that about creation, all that, we sit here and we say, and Paul, who's writing this, like I just said, had been stoned almost to death, had been in prison. And we're not talking about prisons with HBO, okay? We're talking about prisons that are holes in the ground with a guard above it, right? Terrible conditions. This man had seen everything stripped from him. He was a wealthy Jewish leader, a Jew amongst Jews. He was going to be top, top rabbi, right? He was on his way, and then he met Jesus, and it ruined his life and changed him forever. And he then began to go and recklessly follow after Christ and literally was one of the most prolific authors of the New Testament, and why we have God's word that he speaks through him and many people were saved. He was the first apostle, missionary, church planter, whatever you want to call him. And he says this, out of all the suffering, he will one day be a martyr. And he says this, for I consider that the sufferings of this present time, our time now, not the future to come, not the past behind us, this present time, not worth comparing to the glory that would be revealed to us. I don't know many people who don't have to work to have that theology of suffering, and they can claim Romans 8:18 in their lives. Just carte blanche. I've met a few, and it's usually older folks who have gone through a lot of storms in lives before they can actually say, "For I consider that the sufferings of this world are just, they're nothing compared to what's gonna come." Because they understand that the earth is in futility, it's broken. And the reason why it's broken is because of sin, our collective sin, Adam's sin that bared on the earth. And so when we see that and the suffering comes, now here's the thing. This is not a sermon to say, rub some dirt on it, pull your bootstraps up and get over it. I've heard that sermon and this is not it. We will mourn still. When we lose loved ones, we will mourn. But Jesus says those who mourn will be what? Comforted. We will grieve the loss as we should grieve the loss. But that's what's special and awesome about Jesus, that he doesn't leave us alone, but he brings us together as a community known as the church, and we suffer together. We rejoice together. We become a place where it's okay not to be okay. We come to a place where victory is had because addiction is gone. We come to a place where people come to know Christ and we are. If someone comes to know Jesus in this church on a Sunday morning, it should jack you up just as much as the time you met Jesus. I'm being straight. Like if someone says, "I believe that I'm a sinner and I need to repent of my sins and I trust that Jesus has taken those sins from me through his death, life, and resurrection. I believe that. He's my Lord and Savior. I'll follow him the rest of your day." We should throw a stinking party. Like seriously, we should have like cake on hand, ready to go. Bring out the salvation cake. You know, and do the whole bit because man, that is a party because the angels in heaven are partying. I mean, that's biblical. They're throwing a big shindig because one person came to know Jesus. And what do we get? That's beautiful. Praise him. We should just be ecstatic, right? Because they just went from death to life, and though they will still have to endure the futility of this world, they now see the futility as hope at the end of this, because then they can see their present sufferings, not at this present time, are not worth comparing to what now they just inherited, which is a kingdom with God forever and ever, amen. That's life, guys. That's where it's at. And so the next time a storm of life hits you, I'm not asking you to step back and go, "This doesn't bother me. We just lost a child, no big deal. I just lost a job, no big deal. We can't have children, no big deal. We're good, we love Jesus." You grieve, you mourn, but you don't do it without hope. And us as a church family will guide you and surround you and give you whatever you need so that when that time is over and you see God has taken you through that time and made you stronger and use that trial in your life to be a testimony to his glory and to his goodness, and then you can impact someone else who's going through the exact same thing and say, "The reason why I went through this, the reason why I survived this is because of Jesus and because of my church family." That's why we're here, and if that's not what we're doing, then why do it? I mean, if you were suffering, listen to me, if you were suffering alone, quietly, by yourself, I don't care if it's sin, I don't care if it's a situation you can't handle, if it's something in your realm and you've not let anyone know about it because you're afraid that someone's gonna judge you or talk to you, just come to me. If you have nobody else you can come to me. I don't really care if we've never even met. Come to me and we'll talk, because I promise you, my rap sheet is just as bad as yours. And yet God, for some crazy reason, decided to save me. And some crazy reason decided me to suffer well and see the hope at the end of this and made me a pastor, more insanity. And yet I know there is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. I know that there is hope at the end of this journey. Look, Cassie and I lost 2 kids through miscarriage. We have then now had the doctor. I remember in Tulsa, Oklahoma, being in an office and the psychiatrist telling me, "Your son has a progressive autism. He'll never do," and she just listed the things he'll never do. "He'll never leave the home. He'll never be potty trained. He'll never speak. He'll never read. Have you met my son Noah? He talks. He sings to Jesus. He talks about scripture. He's potty trained." Amen. And the reality is he has been made whole, and he's a testimony because he is a revelation that there is hope at the end of this journey. Some of us don't get to do that though. Some of us will suffer and have those situations in our lives forever. And we will never see the end of it until Jesus comes or we die. That's just it. But the thing is, that was the appropriate response from sin, and we suffer and we don't look for anything else than what we have in Jesus. Because if we have Jesus, we have everything. We have hope, we have life, we have glory rushing through our veins, and we have a Holy Spirit that intercedes on behalf of what we're just about to talk about. He works all things for good for those who are called to his name. It is not about your present circumstances that is making you happy. It's about the glory to come and the relationship you have now. Amen. Suffering's terrible. I hate it. I hate it for you because as your pastor, when you go through it, guess who goes through it too? I hate it for you. And I wish there was something I could pray or say or do that block it from this church, but it's coming. But we will not let it have control. For we are controlled by Jesus. We have hope for the glory to come. I'm done yelling at you. Okay, here we go. Oh man, that was a lot of yelling. I'm just gonna go off script. Let's just do this. Okay. Verse 23. And not the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons. That's grieving. That's grieving. When you're at the hospital bed holding mom's hand. When the spouse comes home and says, I lost the job. We wait and we hope for the revealing of the sons of God, for the glory to come. Verse 24, for in the hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. I don't know why that just gives me the chills when I think about that. That means on your very worst day, when you don't know what to say and life has slapped you in the face, the Spirit is interceding on your behalf with groanings too deep for words and interceding on your behalf, just as Christ interceded on our behalf at the cross. Now we have the Holy Spirit dwelling inside us interceding on our behalf to God. Have you ever had the prayer with no words? Okay, you're all looking at me like I'm crazy. Okay, let me explain. Well, I'm crazy, but there was moments in my life where I need to pray. I need to pray over a situation. It's hard, something difficult's happened, and I'm just like, I got nothing. Have you been there? Amen? You just got nothing. Good, okay, I thought I was alone. All of you are looking at me like, what? It's the prayer of the Spirit. John and Hannah Ware are sweet, dear friends of ours. They live in Texas, but they're not those Texans. Like, you can be around them, and they're not going to talk about Texas every 5 seconds, you know? So they're great Texans. I can say that as a Texan, I'm allowed. We've been church planning for just a few weeks, and I got a call from John, one of my very dear friends, and he said, Hannah's in labor. I was like, ooh. I don't know much about biology, but that's way too soon. And it was. And so I go to the hospital. And I walk into the door. And I had found out on my way there, one of the family members called me and said, hey, the baby was only around for about 30 minutes. Okay. Yeah, I understand. You know, and so as a pastor, how do you prepare for that, you know? How do you go in that saying, this is my good friend, so he's seen me at my worst, right? Like, he's prayed for me. So how do you go and minister to one of your good friends that, and so I'm on the other side of that door, and I know Hannah and John are sitting in that room, and I'm just going, okay. And like, every nurse is walking past me like, why is he just standing at the side of the door? And I'm staring at their room number, and I'm just going, okay, okay, okay. And just expecting gnashing of teeth and grieving. I mean, that's what I would be at, right? I open the door, and Hannah and John are praying with one of their other family members, and then John sees me. Now, John is 6'7". He's a big man. And he comes rushing towards me and holds me, lifts me up off the ground. And he says, I got to dance with my daughter for 30 minutes. Because the doctors had told him she's not even going to make it, but she was alive for 30 whole minutes. And John decided he was going to take a couple of those minutes to dance with a daughter he'll never get to do at the wedding. And they grieved, and we cried for hours, and we mourned, but in that room was hope. Hannah, the wife, looked at me, and I said, "Hannah, I am so sorry." And she said, "I am too. I'm going to miss her. She was so beautiful. But I'm glad she gets to skip all of this." We're the ones who have to toil in the now. We're the ones who are suffering now. Hannah saw her daughter, sweet, sweet, precious daughter, as ones that got to be held by Jesus that day. That feeling you get right there, that moment of clarity and hope in the midst of suffering, that portion of God's grace is what it's going to feel like for eternity. And that's why Paul understood the theology of suffering and said, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing for the glory that will be revealed to us." Why? And it goes back to this every single time. For there is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. There'd be no glory to be revealed to. There'd be no happiness to find if there was condemnation. But there is no condemnation. There is life in Jesus. And that's why every Sunday we plead with you, trust Jesus, follow Jesus, believe in Jesus, love Jesus for the glory to come. Now, we can't have the opposite reaction. Like, we can't let the pendulum swing and say, "I'm not going to tell anybody about Jesus. I'm not really going to care about church. I'm not really going to care about anybody else. I've just got me and Jesus. I'm on my walk. I'm just going to do this with him because there's heaven waiting for me. I'm going to get my mansion in the sky," you know. And what's that really bad old hymn about that? Anyway, it's a really terrible heretical theological hymn that we used to sing all the time about your mansion in the sky. Anyway, we don't sing that here. The reality is that we can't just look. Have you heard of the things like, you're so heavenly minded, you're not earthly good? Okay, here's the reality. You can never be too heavenly minded. Amen? But the heavenly minded doesn't just come individually and go, "I've got to be on this track to finally come to the point where I am with one with God and I'm just walking with him as a son of God." You're so heavenly minded, you want other people to join you. You know you can get heaven on earth right now? You can have glimpses of heaven on earth when someone in your life looks at you and says, "I believe in the Jesus you just told me about. I need him." That's heaven on earth for me. There's no greater joy for me as a pastor than salvation. I mean, I'm serious. Like, baptism's fantastic. Worship service is wonderful. Mission revivals, whatever we do. I don't know where we said that. We don't do those either. The thing is, whatever it is, small groups, missions, respite care for orphans, I mean, all that fantastic stuff, salvation is where it's at. Because that's what you can say. We will suffer together until the end of this life when Jesus returns or you go to heaven and the glory revealed to us will be there because you are no longer condemned because you are in Christ Jesus. Wrapping it up and I'm done, I promise. I'm ahead of schedule. Never mind, 30 more minutes. First time guests were like, "Is he serious?" Yeah. All right, here we go. "Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God." And that's a whole other sermon I don't have time for. "And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose." I think that's where we're going to land for the day. Now, here's the thing. Verse warning. Sirens, okay? See this verse in context of the entire suffer narrative that we've just talked about, okay? You can't pluck this verse out by itself, put it on a placard in your wall, put it on a coffee mug, and just, that's it, right? That verse has to be known in context, okay? I mean, a major theme of the Bible is suffering. We see it throughout. Jesus suffered here on earth. He suffered the ultimate cost for our sins, right? So when you read, "God works all things out for those who are good," your theology of suffering can be broken and go, well, I mean, just trust God, and he's called me, and I know Jesus, and everything's going to work out for good, except when the storm hits you in your life, and you realize that, oh, wow, like, this verse isn't true at all, and I'm just going to give up on God. I've said this before. My first sermon I ever preached when I was a young whippersnapper of an intern that knew nothing whatsoever, I preached on Jesus calming the storms, and it was complete heresy, absolute heresy, in front of a bunch of little ladies in Southern Baptist world on a Wednesday night. Thankfully, the pastor was smart. He goes, you preach Wednesday night, not Sunday morning. He was smart. He's a wise man. And so I was sitting there, and I was like, and Jesus came up out of the stern of the boat and calmed the storms. And he said, oh, ye of little faith. And if you have faith today, he can calm your storms just like that. That's heresy. That is absolute nonsense. The pastor pulled me aside, and he goes, so you're going to preach again, but in 6 months after we talk a lot. Because we all know, after we met Christ, and now if you haven't met Christ yet, there is no hope. But if you have met Christ, you know Christ, you follow Christ, you know the troubles did not end there. Did they? Amen? Troubles didn't end there. The futility continued, but the futility now has hope. God works all things out for good. That means he is a sovereign over every situation. And I know that's a lot to take in. And I know that we can, what about this, what about this, what about this? God didn't say, well, I'm going to be sovereign over the good times, but I'm not going to be sovereign over the bad times. That's when I'm just going to ignore it. He works all things out for good. And his good is always our best. His good is so much better than the good that we could ever manifest, that if we just cling on to what he's trying to do and what he is doing in our lives, even in the midst of suffering, we will find joy, peace, happiness, hope at the end of that trial. And that end may be death. But then you meet Jesus. When we work all things out for good, please do not let that verse alone mean the circumstances of your life now. Go back to what Paul says in 18. For I consider the sufferings of when? Of when? This present time, now. It means sufferings happen to Paul now. So how can we possibly, in any realm of Christianity, say, if we have Jesus, there's no more trials? Paul himself is saying, in this present time, there is sufferings, but they don't compare to what's being revealed. And some people will even say, well, that was back in biblical days. Are we not in biblical days now? Are we not the next chapter of Acts now? I mean, when the book ended, that was just the church's beginning, and we're here now in biblical days. We're in days of Jehovah Jireh. We're in the days of the Messiah Lord. We're in the days of Jesus longing and waiting for his return. There is sufferings here and we know it, but the sufferings have hope in them because we now have Christ. And I'm telling you, if you don't have Jesus this morning, you're like, whatever, man. I've like lost a job. I've lost loved ones and I'm still miserable. Sister, brother, friend, guest, I'm telling you, with Jesus, you now have a suffering theological perspective that allows you hope. I could never get through anything of that God has thrown my way or the world has thrown my way if it had not been for Jesus. I would never get through it. I would literally never survive college without Jesus. He works all things out for good. It's his good, his glory, which always means our joy. And yeah, it stinks, man. Like, it's hard. But you weren't supposed to look at this place as the last stop. Creation is groaning. It's right along there with you, waiting for Jesus to return. But in Christ, at least you have a Messiah returning. Everybody else doesn't. This is the end for them. Can you imagine? Christians in this room, can you imagine that? Some of you can because you just became a Christian not 10 years ago, 5 years ago, 2 years ago. You can imagine that. And I really believe those who come to know Christ later in life have a deeper appreciation because they're mature enough to understand, ooh, adulthood outside of Jesus, not fun. No hope, because it begins and ends with you and your abilities and your circumstances and your luck, right? I know some of you thought you were going to win the billion-dollar whatever Powerball, and I know you were going to give most of it to the church. I appreciate that, but the thing is, Shepherd's going to be a next meeting in Maui. Anyway, we're not that kind of church. I'm the Scrooge. I'd be like, put it in the bank. We're not touching it for another 20 years. Like, that's my default. Don't spend anything. Anyway, except it's for you. We love spending on you. Here's all I have to say, and I'm just going to try to wrap this down. And I know this is hard, and this is not like a yay, happy sermon Sunday morning, right? And I'm not going to go another 30 minutes, but it starts at verse 1. There's no condemnation in Christ Jesus, though we all deserve condemnation. Your sins, my sins, subjected the earth to futility in hope. This earth is broken. We are broken. And our sin is an offense to a righteous, holy God who is perfect in every way, who never has an inkling of a thought of bad, evil, anything inside of him, ever. His ways are always pure. And so how can that possibly be that we have a relationship with him and have this hope? It's because of Jesus, because in Jesus, there's no condemnation. In Jesus, he takes the condemnation from us and gives us his righteousness. It's called the Great Exchange. Because there's no condemnation in Jesus, then we, as sons and daughters of the Most High God, have been adopted to a heavenly family, that we are, though still here on this earth, suffering well through all the tragedy and the heartache, but we not suffer the futility of this world and this life without hope, because we have hope. Why? Because there's no condemnation in Christ Jesus. And so as we suffer, then we together find one another and go, everyone in this person in this room has something in common. You're sinners in need of grace. That's your common thread. I don't care what economic background you come from, your race, creed, I don't care. I don't care what your education is, okay? All of us have a common thread that we needed someone to die for us in order to be saved. And it's really beautiful if you really think about it. We always talk about equality, especially in this day and age. We're talking about equality, equality, equality. What better equality is the fact that we're all sinners on a road to destruction and death if we don't find Jesus? There's equality to me right there. But we are adopted through Jesus because there's no condemnation in Christ. And the creation itself, though it's set to futility, it was set there in hope, knowing that there'll be a day where there'll be no more tears, no more sickness, no more sadness, when Jesus comes and reclaims what is rightfully his, this creation and you. And we will resurrect with new bodies. And those who have fallen before us will be there with us, who have loved and followed Jesus. Because God works all things for good. And he will receive all the glory, and his good is always so much better than our definition of good. So I'm begging you this morning, and I feel like some of you are just on the cusp. I feel like you're just right there, ready to say yes to Jesus. I am begging you. I do not have the answer on how you get a better job. I don't have the answer, ultimately, why grandma got cancer. I don't know, other than this world is broken, we're broken, but there's hope. And I don't never met a counselor, a pragmatic steps to a better life book. I've never met any resource that has given me any type of hope like the hope I have in Jesus. I'm inviting you. Actually, I'm not doing a thing. I mean, if we're going to be straight. I am just telling you what happened to me and many people in this room and happened to you as well. God is pounding on the hardness of your heart, trying to break it and give you a heart of flesh to believe, to have faith. And this morning, you can do that. This morning, you can say, I am a sinner condemned because of my sin, because God is holy and righteous and can't be near my sin. I have become an enemy of God because of my sin, but I believe that he sent his son Jesus to die on the cross for my sins, a death that I totally deserved, but that death did not hold him there. And 3 days later, he arose and all the promises of God became true. And now I can raise from the ashes of my sin, have new life in Christ where there is no condemnation, and all things will work out for my good, and the sufferings of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of his grace. Let's pray. Father, this is just hard because we want answers and we want them now. It's hard because there's not anybody in this room probably that hasn't been touched by suffering. It's hard because some of us are just playing around with this religious thing and it's just felt dead and cold to us for so many years. But this morning, Father, I pray that there's rest found in your Son, Jesus. Jesus says, all who come to me who are weary will find rest. And I pray that someone here this morning will find the first rest they've ever felt eternally in Jesus. God, look, I'm just going to ask you to save somebody this morning if they need saving. Let Jesus be real to them this morning if they need Jesus. Call them to be your son, to be your daughter. Let them know there's hope. Let them know they're not alone. Let them know we're just all a bunch of former rebels clinging to the mercies of grace every single day, and we need just as much Jesus today as we did the first day we met him. We don't have it together. We don't know everything, Lord, but you do. And you're working it all out for your good, which is always our hope and our joy. For those who know Jesus this morning, Father, who has become a follower of Christ either recently or has their entire lives, this morning, I hope and pray that the next time a storm comes, that they can look back at this passage and realize there's no condemnation in Jesus. They can weather this storm. Even though they may never see the end of it, they can weather it because there is hope in the glory to be revealed to the sons and daughters of God as they arrive and be made known. Holy Spirit, please woo who you need to woo. Call who you need to call. Deal with who you need to deal with. God, have mercy on us. And thank you for all the grace and all the mercy and all the love you've brought to us in Jesus. And because of that, you are a good God, a holy God, a righteous God, and worthy for our praises forever.